So I understand that everybody here knows what integrability means. And Igor just explained that the notion is very relative. So I'll not explain what Liouville integrability means. I'll focus on the property of Hamiltonian dynamical systems, which is slightly stronger than the Liouville integrability, and we will see why. So I'll start with this, and then in the next lecture, I'll focus on spin Calogero-Moser type systems, and then at the end, in the third lecture, what is a superintegrable Hamiltonian system? So, as in the previous lecture, we have a phase space. This is where the Hamiltonian dynamical system will be evolving. It's a symplectic manifold. And I assume that it's a question to students. I assume that everybody knows what the symplectic manifold is. I also assume that what?
You just defined it.
I just defined it, yes. It's a pair, it's an even dimensional manifold with closed form and non-degenerate form. So the important feature of symplectic manifold is that functions in symplectic manifold form a Poisson algebra. So a Poisson algebra, it's an algebra with two structures. It's a commutative algebra and it's a Lie algebra. And these two structures are compatible in the sense that the Lie algebra acts by derivations on the commutative algebra. So in this case, the commutative multiplication is the usual pointwise multiplication, and the Lie bracket is so-called Poisson bracket. So it's defined through the bivector field, the Poisson tensor, which is the inverse to the symplectic form. Now, let me just ask students, please raise your hands if you know what a Poisson manifold is. Those who know what Poisson manifold is. Okay, I think more or less everybody knows. So. Okay, so it's a nice exercise here to check that the Jacobi identity for this Lie bracket is the same as the closeness of this two form. So more general, M is a Poisson manifold. If we have a Poisson tensor, that's the bivector field P. So using this by vector field, we can define the bracket just in the same way as before. But now the condition on P will be just that this bracket should satisfy the Jacobi identity. This gives some quadratic differential identity for P. So that's the notion of a Poisson manifold. And clearly, symplectic manifold is an example of a Poisson manifold. So algebra of functions on a Poisson manifold is a Poisson algebra, again, with pointwise multiplication and with the Poisson bracket. So now we have a notion of a Poisson algebra, and we have a notion of a Poisson subalgebra. So that's the commutative subalgebra and a Lie subalgebra. Geometrically, it means that we have two Poisson manifolds, M and N, and a projection from M to N such that it brings this bivector field to project to the bivector field P prime. So, so that's an important notion. And then just in the same, continuing this line of Poisson algebras, we have a natural natural algebra that can be associated to a pair, a Poisson algebra and a Poisson subalgebra. That's the Poisson centralizer of B in A. In other words, these are all elements in A which Poisson commute with elements in B. And it's a nice exercise to check that a Poisson centralizer of a Poisson subalgebra is also a Poisson subalgebra. So that will be a homework. So, and now I'll be just using this notion that commutative algebra has rank k if it has k independent elements. That's the Krull dimension of this algebra B. Or if B is the algebra of functions on some manifold, that's the dimension of this manifold. So these are some preliminaries that I need to define the notion of a superintegrable system. So now, an algebraic definition. So a superintegrable system on a Poisson algebra A is a Poisson commutative, is a choice of a Poisson commutative subalgebra I of rank k that can be less than n, such that the rank of the centralizer is 2n minus k. So again, we have a Poisson commutative subalgebra of Hamiltonians of our system. And it's rank k, so there are k independent Hamiltonians. And then the rank of the centralizer in this case, when we have a superintegrable system, it's equal to 2n minus k. You know, I mean, this Poisson subalgebra doesn't have to be commutative. It cannot be commutative if k is less than n. So this is the subalgebra of first integrals of the quantities that are preserved when we evolve the, when we choose a Hamiltonian from this subalgebra I, and we'll consider the Hamiltonian evolution. So all these quantities will be preserved. These are the first integrals. Yes, Liouville integrability is when k equals n. So that's exactly the first example of a superintegrable system, going back to the Liouville integrability. Well, the second kind of trivial example is consider the symplectic space with the standard symplectic form. Let's choose as our integrals, as our Hamiltonians, functions of p1 and pk. So then obviously the Poisson centralizer of this subalgebra will be functions depending on p1, pn, qk plus 1, and qn. We cannot have q1, qk, because otherwise they wouldn't Poisson commute with these functions. So this is a kind of locally, that's how all superintegrable systems look like. And then after this general introduction, I'll focus on spin Calogero-Moser systems, and that will be the third example, and then at the end of the day we will have the plenty of examples related to moduli spaces. Yes, there is no contradiction. So I'll explain why there is no contradiction. And also, by usual Calogero-Moser system, so let's be very precise. So there are rational. Yes, so usual spin Calogero-Moser systems, they come in three kind of classes. The usual one, that's the rational one, the trigonometric one, the Calogero-Moser-Sutherland spin system, and the elliptic one. The elliptic one is probably not superintegrable. It's Liouville integrable. I'm talking about Calogero-Moser-Sutherland system. That's when the elliptic curves degenerate, and that's related to this. So, okay, so now, typically, when you have a Poisson commutative subalgebra, its centralizer coincide with the subalgebra itself. Say, if you have, typically, if you have a function on a symplectic manifold or on a Poisson manifold, so how many other functions will Poisson commute with this given one? Usually, only function itself and functions of this function. So it's a question of, say, if you have a Hamiltonian dynamics on a symplectic manifold, how many first integrals will you have? Typically, none. So that's a typical situation here, that the centralizer of a Poisson commutative subalgebra, usually it's the subalgebra itself. And when you say that the rank of the centralizer is 2n minus k, this is the maximal possible rank of the centralizer. So it's a very strong, actually, property. It's not, I mean, it shouldn't be easy to find such systems. They're highly non-typical. So that's the first remark. And by the way, when k equals n, yes, so then it's the then it's okay for it to be I, because it's the maximal possible rank will be n again. So we have Poisson inclusions. Our big algebra A functions on the phase space. The subalgebra, Poisson commutative subalgebra of Hamiltonians, and then in between there is this centralizer. And remember that here the rank is 2n, here the rank is k, and here the rank is 2n minus k. So the sum of those is equal to the rank of the of our algebra of observables. So algebra geometrically, we can say that, say, if all these are Noetherian algebras, then we have these algebraic varieties, symplectic algebraic variety M of dimension 2n, Poisson algebraic variety of dimension 2n minus k, and the variety BK with trivial Poisson structure. And these inclusions of Poisson algebras dually sort of on the language of these algebraic varieties, these are simply the projections, Poisson projections, surjective Poisson projections from our phase space to this intermediate Poisson manifold P, and then to the base of the projection. If this is a Liouville integrability, then k equals n, we don't have the intermediate object. This is just the usual Lagrangian vibration that we understand as an integrable Hamiltonian system on M. So this sort of gives the geometric understanding of geometric definition of superintegrability. So this is a Poisson projection from our phase space, surjective projection, to some Poisson manifold of dimension 2n minus k, and then further projection to the Poisson projection to the trivial Poisson manifold of dimension k. Now, connected components of fibers of this projection, they are symplectic leaves of this Poisson manifold. And of course, if you take the, so then fibers of P1 are isotropic k-dimensional submanifolds. The fact that they are typically k-dimensional is clear, because the dimension here is 2n minus k. They are isotropic because this is a Poisson projection to Poisson manifold of, also the case. So this is the geometric definition of superintegrability. So we have the phase space 2n dimensional, an intermediate Poisson manifold of dimension 2n minus k, and k-dimensional base. And again, algebraically.
So why 2n minus k is equal
Pardon?
Why 2n minus k is even? Because
2n minus k is not even.
But if it's, they are simply.
No, it's 2n no. minus 2k is even.
Fibers are of dimension 2n minus 2k. So it's okay. All right, so remarks. If you take the if you take the total projection, if you compose P1 and P2, the fibers here will be 2n minus k dimensional, and they will be co-isotropic submanifolds of dimension 2n minus k. So this is a Poisson manifold of dimension 2n minus k. The fibers of the total projection will be co-isotropic of dimension 2n minus k. And they are related in a way that if you will take the fiber of P2, so if you will take a fiber of P2, connected components are symplectic leaves. And now you can identify those symplectic leaves with the following. You take the total projection from M to B, take a fiber of this total projection. It's a co-isotropic submanifold of dimension 2n minus k. Now, a co-isotropic submanifold you can symplectically reduce. And then you get the symplectic manifold, which is the symplectic reduction of this symplectic reduction of this fiber. And the point is that symplectic leaves of these intermediate Poisson manifolds are exactly symplectic reductions of the corresponding fibers of the total projection. So this is just a recollection of what symplectic reduction is. So, okay, so just want to repeat again that we have this structure dually. We have the Poisson projections P1 and P2 with all the properties that I was describing here. So so think of this as a kind of certain structure that you have for a superintegrable system. And then if you want to have a superintegrable Hamiltonian dynamics, all you have to do is you have to choose the Hamiltonian from this Poisson commutative subalgebra, and that will be your superintegrable Hamiltonian system. Okay, so these are all the definitions, and now why this is this structure is remarkable? Well, because it refines the Liouville integrability. So this theorem is due to Nikhoroshev from the, I think he, the work is going back to the 70s. And this notion of superintegrability, it has a certain history. So first, First examples of superintegrable systems. I mean, really first example of a superintegrable system that's interesting is the hydrogen atom. Or if you prefer to think about sort of grand scales, this is a Kepler system in this is a Kepler system sort of in planetary dynamics. So this So the fact that these are superintegrable systems, it goes back to Pauli and Fock. So they observed that there is this. So the Hamiltonian of this system is, you know, it's the phase space is six-dimensional. It's the cotangent bundle to R3. And it's an attractive Hamiltonian. So this is the Hamiltonian. And there is a natural symmetry that's the rotational symmetry. But there is also so-called Lenz vector that gives an extra symmetry to the problem. And as a result, it has this structure of a superintegrable system that was essentially described in these works. And this is why we have this complicated, how it's called, the structure of the spectrum of the hydrogen.
There are three components of this spectrum.
Yeah. It's because of the dependencies. So there is a vector of the moment of corresponding to the usual momentum vector. There is a Lenz vector. So altogether there are six of them, and then there are relations. So because of the relations, it's five-dimensional. So it's, and the fibers of this projection, the symplectic leaves of P, they are quite different. They depend on what is the value of the Hamiltonian. So for example, if you have the negative values of the Hamiltonian, then these fibers are compact. And I'm talking about something that I didn't want to talk about. but I think it's inevitable. So here's the structure of the integrability of this superintegrability of the Kepler system. These are the values of the Hamiltonian. There are three special cases. When the Hamiltonian is less than zero, then symplectic leaves are simply S2 cross S2. And the quantization of these symplectic leaves gives exactly the structure of the discrete spectrum of the Hamiltonian. So here, symplectic leaves are coadjoint orbits in E3. So for the zero level, the symplectic leaf is just the cotangent bundle to S2, and here the symplectic leaves are certain hyperboloids. These are the coadjoint orbits in SO31. It's the Lie algebra, it's small. So this is the hidden Lorentz symmetry in the hydrogen atom. So it's quite an interesting example. And this is the beginning of the history of superintegrable systems. And then I think for a while the name was the integrable systems with inner symmetries. So then the next examples came in the work of physicists Winternitz, Smorodinsky, and kind of group of people who worked with them. So then after this, there was certain development in the field. And the name appeared sort of this strange, oh no. There was also these papers by Mishenko and Fomenko. They called it non-commutative integrability. Nikhorashev called it degenerate integrability. Actually, for good reasons, because the quantization of these integrable systems will gives the quantum Hamiltonians with degenerate, highly degenerate spectrum. So the names were hidden symmetry, integrable systems with hidden symmetry, degenerate integrable systems, non-commutative integrable systems. Non-commutative because these systems have first integrals which are not Poisson commutative. So that's a very simple reason. Sorry, it's very dry. So, but then, of course, the name that got stuck to these systems is superintegrable, which is absolutely terrible name, because there is nothing super here. Wojciechowski, he introduced this notion, and then the notion got stuck to them. So this is sort of the long apology for this terrible name, but there is nothing can be done about it now. So now the theorem, the Liouville theorem, so Nikhorashev theorem. So first, if you have a Hamiltonian which belong to this subalgebra I of Poisson commuting Hamiltonians, then flow lines of this of the vector field that's generated by this Hamiltonian, of this Hamiltonian vector field, they belong to They belong to connected components of fibers of this first projection. So it should be P1. It should be P1, and B should not be B. It should be some point from P. So to this k-dimensional connected component of this projection, of the fiber of this projection. So the flow lines. So now let's do the following. Let's choose a maximal independent set in our algebra of Hamiltonians. So the flow lines of these Hamiltonians, they generate a local coordinate system T1, TK. If you choose the different set of independent Hamiltonians, you will have a different coordinate system, local coordinate system. All these Hamiltonians, they have fixed value on this fiber. So this altogether, these choices, they generate an affine coordinate system on the fibers. And that's the exactly the analog of the Liouville theorem. So that you can say that this Poisson commutative subalgebra generates an affine coordinate system on each of these fibers. And then, just as in the Liouville theorem, what you have here is the action of a torus of an abelian group on the fibers, and it's the same topological theorem as in the Liouville theorem, that every connected component is isomorphic to the product of a torus and the vector space Rm. So then, in this coordinate system that I mentioned, the flow lines are linear. So that's just, it's all completely parallel to the usual Liouville theorem. The only significant differences are here in the action angle variables. So if you fix a point C on this intermediate Poisson manifold in the vicinity of the pre-image of this point, the symplectic form can be written in the following way. So T1, TK are these angle coordinates on the Liouville toroid that I was talking about. I1, IK, these are the independent functions, the angle, the action coordinates, again, that I was talking about. But then this is not the whole symplectic form. So the symplectic form here can be brought to this form. It's the action angle variables plus the pullback of the symplectic form from the symplectic leaf on which contains this point C. Okay, so this is the kind of version of a Liouville theorem, and you can see why you can justify the name superintegrability, because it's stronger than the Liouville system. Stronger than Liouville integrability in the following sense. If you have a Liouville integrable system, then all you can say is that the evolution of this system belongs to an n-dimensional torus. Let's say that it's a compact case. So you don't know whether the system spans the whole torus eventually, or whether the all trajectories are periodic and it's effectively one-dimensional. There is no intermediate bound between being periodic and being everywhere dense on the Liouville torus. In these systems, there is an upper bound K. If you know that you're dealing with a superintegrable system, then you know that it can span only a k-dimensional torus in the evolution. It cannot span k plus one dimensional torus because it goes along this Liouville toroid.
But in the Liouville theory, you're saying there are no more than n plus.
Yes.
It's not of dimension equal to n plus one, so it's the same.
No. So here is the notion that sort of explains this. You can say that if you have two superintegrable systems, you can say that one is a refinement of the other if, say, the integrals of the first system is a subset of the integrals of the second system. But now the centralizer of the smaller system, of course, is bigger. So if you have this system of inclusions, you can say that the first system is a refinement of the second system. And in particular, the bigger system, you know, you can have a situation when the second system is a Liouville integrable system. So then you can have a refinement of the Liouville integrability by the superintegrability, which says that in your Liouville integrable system, you have an additional information that the trajectories cannot span everywhere densely the n-dimensional torus. They can only span k-dimensional subtorus. So that's the notion of refinement.
That would be the case, for instance, if you forget the L vector in the...
Exactly, yes. Exactly. Here, so if you forget about the very special nature of this system, then you will have the usual Liouville integrability, and that's, yeah.
This means that for central potential in general will be integrable
Sorry?
The Coulomb potential is superintegrable.
The Coulomb potential is superintegrable.
Generic central potentials instead are integrable.
Yeah.
So at the quantum level, this corresponds to the fact
quantum level? At the quantum level, okay, let me say.
Not the quantum number. The energy doesn't depend on the quantum number. This is the energy do not depend on X, the quantum number.
Right.
In a hydrogen atom.
Yeah.
But if you take generic central potential, you would expect the dependence on
X. Exactly. Exactly. So let me say a few words about quantum, because I think this is a sophisticated audience, so I should say something about quantum. So when we have a classical integrable system and its quantum version, if it's a Liouville integrable system, then typically, let's say that we have classical integrals corresponding quantum operators. Again, I'll be cheating here, otherwise it's difficult to move on. So the question is, what is the structure of the joint spectrum of quantum integrals? So typically here, the multiplicity of every eigenvector is finite, and it's stable as h goes to zero. Stable in the sense that there could be some finite dimensional degeneracies, but they don't depend on h. Okay, that's the Liouville integrability. Now let's look at what happens in the hydrogen atom. So the multiplicity here, the multiplicity of the discrete spectrum when the energy is minus, now I don't remember, n squared?
1 over n
squared. 1 over n squared, yes. C over n squared. So C is some constant. So the multiplicity of this subspace, let's call it Vn, is, well, more or less n squared, maybe n plus or n minus 1 squared. But you can see that there should be some Planck constant somewhere. So in the semi-classical limit, n goes to infinity. And it goes to infinity as, let's say, L over h, where h is the Planck constant. So you can see that multiplicity behaves as h to the minus 2. But 2 is a very special number. 2 is exactly half of the dimension of the fiber here. So when you will try to quantize such systems, remember that the dimension of symplectic leaves in this Poisson manifold is 2n minus 2k. So what you should expect from the multiplicity of the discrete spectrum of the eigenvalues with the discrete spectrum, that they will behave as minus n minus k. So they will be not stable. They will go to infinity, the multiplicity. This is why it's the name degenerate integrable system sort of makes sense from this point of view. So any questions? All right, so this is the end of the first lecture. And if we still have time, then, you know, I can...
Cool. Just
yes.
A remark to
yes.
With uh-huh. Terminology even more terrible.
Okay.
Because in quantum systems, superintegrable was used by this law to say about systems having more than n integrals.
So... It, Well, integrals or Hamiltonians? Because
Hamiltonians or
Poisson commuting or.
In quantum system, you have a commutative algebra with more than n.
Okay.
You cannot have more than n completely independent, but not trivially. So this terminology was only occupied.
I have no choice. Anyway. So should I start the second lecture now or we make a break?
As you prefer, because we started a little bit later because of the problem. So if this is a good point, we can stop or if you want to say something, you can go.
Well, it's a natural point to make a stop. So I'll just, so the next lecture will be more specific. I will specifically describe one family of superintegrable systems, spin Calogero-Moser systems, and that's it. So, break.
Thank you very much. Okay, then we can go upstairs to have some coffee and start back in half an hour.
Of a superintegrable system, and we'll construct this family of spin Calogero-Moser, and I should say not spin Calogero-Moser, but probably spin Calogero-Moser Sutherland systems, because these are the systems with the potential 1 over sine squared qi minus qj. So these are the integrable systems that can be obtained by the Hamiltonian reduction. In terms of the first lecture by Igor, they correspond to degenerate spectral curves when it becomes just points. So first, let me recall the Hamiltonian reduction, and you know, very specific in very specific situation when the initial symplectic manifold is just a cotangent bundle to G. So you know the essence of Lie theory is that global properties of Lie groups can be described locally in terms of tangent space at the identity, and you know the one of the important features of Lie groups is that tangent bundles and cotangent bundles to Lie groups can be trivialized by either left or right translations. So let's trivialize once and for all this by right translations. So G acts on itself by conjugations, and this action can be lifted to the action on the cotangent bundle. In terms of this trivialization, this is the coadjoint action on the first factor and diagonal conjugation on the second factor. So this is the, I'll call it adjoint action of Lie group on the cotangent bundle to itself. This action is Hamiltonian in the sense that if you have an element of the Lie algebra, the corresponding vector field is a Hamiltonian vector field, and well, that's just what it means to be Hamiltonian. You have a natural symplectic structure on T star G, and then this vector field is the corresponding Poisson tensor contracted with the differential of the Hamiltonian. And the Hamiltonian is a linear function of the element x in the Lie algebra. So for the value of the Hamiltonian at point m, we can write any linear functional can be written in this way. So this means that the very well known fact that when you have a Hamiltonian action on a manifold, on a symplectic manifold, you have a moment map That's just the description of the Hamiltonian. That's the map from the from your symplectic manifold to the dual space of the Lie algebra. In this particular case of the hydrogen atom, that's a moment map for the action of the SO3 on the cotangent bundle to R3. So for the adjoint action, it's an easy computation. It's a nice homework to actually verify this. The moment map is given by this formula. It's x minus the co-adjoint action of G inverse on x. So that's an important formula. And now any Hamiltonian action on a symplectic manifold preserves the symplectic form. So the quotient space is a Poisson space in the sense that if you have a smooth point in the vicinity of this smooth point, you have a natural Poisson tensor. That's just the image of the Poisson tensor on T star G with respect to the projection from T star G to this quotient space. So this is just a general fact about the Hamiltonian actions and about the adjoint action of G on T star G. So now let's assume that G is simple. Depending on the context, we assume that G is either algebraic or any real form of a simple algebraic Lie group. So now, as usual, you know, the first word is simple, the second word is let's choose a Borel subgroup. So let's choose a Borel subgroup B. For SLN, Borel sub, well, let's, we can just choose triangular unimodular matrices. So once we choose the Borel subgroup, so maximal commutative in this Borel subgroup is the Cartan, and then the Weyl group acts naturally on the Cartan. So just for simplicity, let's assume that our G is SLN. So Borel is the subgroup of triangular matrices. H is the subgroup of diagonal matrices. And then in this case, the Weyl group is the group of permutations on n elements. And it naturally acts on diagonal matrices by permuting diagonal entries. OK, so this is the setup. So now let's consider a regular part of the Cartan. For SLN, I mean, in general, this is just the subset in the Cartan subgroup where the stabilizer of every element in the Weyl group is trivial. The meaning of this is simply the following. For SLN, these are the diagonal matrices where lambda I is not equal to lambda j. And the regular part of the Lie group is the set of elements in the Lie group which can be conjugated to a regular part of the Cartan. Okay, so these are some very basic definitions. Any questions about this?
Over the real, you want it split or it doesn't matter?
It does matter, but at the moment it doesn't matter. If you really want to talk about real forms, then it can be, it doesn't have to be split. Okay, so now, again, it's an important, well-known fact that the normalizer of the of this subset of regular elements in the group is the semi-direct product of the Weyl group and the Cartan. And just, you know, I want to share the wisdom of the older generation of Dmitry Fuchs. I learned it through Ed Frankel, this wisdom, but he learned it from Fuchs. So who remembers where this thing should be oriented in the semi-direct product? Aha. So I think the source is the same. So it's very easy. One group acts on the other, so there are two hands which act like this. So you see this W acts by permutations on H, so the hands are from W to H. So, okay. So this is the normalizer, say for SLN, this is just the set of permutation matrices. So these are the matrices where there is exactly one non-zero element in every column and every row. So now let's consider the cotangent bundle to the regular part of the Lie group. It's an open subset in here. And again, we can trivialize it so that it's the G star cross G regular. And here's the very explicit description of the quotient space of the cotangent bundle to this regular part of G with respect to the adjoint. So it's a Poisson manifold, well, manifold in the sense that it can have some, actually this one doesn't have singularity. So as a Poisson manifold, as a Poisson orbifold, it's isomorphic to the following. The quotient of G star with respect to the adjoint, with respect to the coadjoint action of the Cartan times this symplectic manifold, and then the diagonal quotient with respect to the diagonal action of the Weyl group. So I just want to emphasize that the Weyl group doesn't act on G star. It's only the normalizer of the regular, I mean the normalizer of H is a subgroup. It's a subgroup in G, so it acts via coadjoint action. But then once you quotient with respect to the coadjoint action of the Cartan, on this Poisson space, the Weyl group acts, and so this is the description of the quotient space. So let's prove this.
I didn't get this remark. You said the Weyl group doesn't act.
If you don't have this quotient, Weyl group doesn't act here. But the normalizer, the semi-direct product, it's a subgroup in G. G itself acts via the coadjoint action, so the normalizer also acts. But then because it's the semi-direct product, you can first quotient by the by H and then the W acts. Okay, so the action is Hamiltonian, and okay, so then symplectic leaves. Symplectic leaves of this Poisson variety, they can be obtained by the standard procedure with the moment map. So I just recall that the moment map is given by this formula. And so symplectic leaves in our quotient space, they can be described as the following. You take the pre-image of a coadjoint orbit O and quotient by the adjoint action of G. So symplectic leaves are naturally parametrized by coadjoint orbits in the Lie group. So we have this Poisson variety T star G mod adjoint G, the regular part of it, symplectic leaves. And now the phase space of the spin Calogero-Moser is exactly corresponding to the coadjoint orbit O is exactly such symplectically. That's the definition. So on these symplectic varieties, we will construct Hamiltonian systems, and we'll see that these systems are superintegrable. So this is the kind of explicit, if you take into account what the moment map is. So this is just the description of the regular part of the symplectic leaf. So it's the set of points from G star cross G regular part. This is the condition that the moment map brings this point to the coadjoint orbit. And then your quotient is set by the adjoint action of G. So the theorem is that this symplectic orbifold is isomorphic to the following. One has to take the Hamiltonian reduction of the coadjoint orbit O with respect to the action of the Cartan. So the orbit is a subspace in G star. It's a symplectic manifold. So the Cartan acts naturally on this orbit. The action is Hamiltonian. So we can take the Hamiltonian reduction of this symplectic manifold. This is the coadjoint, cotangent bundle to the regular part. And then the W, the Weyl group, acts naturally on this thing. So we take the quotient with respect to the W. So that's the theorem. Let's prove it. Let's prove it for SLN. So remember that points of the symplectic manifold S are orbits of the adjoint action of G through points in T star G, provided that we have this moment map condition. So let's choose very special representatives of these orbits. So let's assume that G is BH B inverse, H is from the regular part of the Cartan, and to keep the action diagonal, let's say that X tilde is something that's brought to X by the coadjoint action of B. So then we can say that the regular part of this symplectic leaf are pairs X tilde H. Now X tilde in G star, H is in the regular part of the Cartan, with the condition that X tilde minus the coadjoint action of H inverse to X tilde should belong to our orbit O. And then we mod out this by the normalizer of the Cartan, of the regular part of the Cartan. So let's compute this this space. Let's assume that, for simplicity, that G is SLN, but it's not essential, just for simplicity. So then our H is the diagonal matrix. The condition is this condition X tilde minus the coadjoint action of H inverse on X tilde reads this way. So here, mu ij are coordinate functions on the coadjoint orbit corresponding to the standard matrix basis of elementary matrices. So I think here it's everything is clear. It's a linear algebra. So any questions before I turn the page? Everything is complex here. Yes, and then you can choose a real slice, the one that you like. Okay, so just one remark that these mu are not arbitrary, they are constrained in the sense that we fix the Casimirs, and in the compact case, once you fix these Casimirs, it fixes you the coadjoint orbit. In the complex case, there could be some components and so on. But these Casimirs are constant on coadjoint orbits. So now all we have to do is we have to solve this equations for x tilde in terms of coordinate functions on the coadjoint orbit and our diagonal matrices H. So now just we take this equation, and if I is equal to J, you can see that it's on the left we have zero. So that means that mu II should be zero, otherwise there is no solution. So this is the first equation. And then the second equation, if I is not equal to J, we have x tilde ij, and then 1 minus hi inverse hj, and that gives the formula for x tilde ij. So x tilde ii is not determined. So the coordinate functions on our symplectic leaf are x tilde ii mu ij with the condition mu ii is zero and hi. So this is what's written here. We have we proved that our symplectic leaf is equal to O zero. That's the part of the symplectic leaf with this condition cross H dual. These are the XII tilde coordinates times H regular. These are the HIs. So, and then we have to mod out this by the normalizer of the Cartan. So this is H dual, this is H regular. So far it's just a trivial linear algebra. So you can see that there is some kind of funny thing that every quadjoint orbit is even dimensional. It's a symplectic manifold. It's this with the Kirillov constant symplectic structure. But now this one has conditions, but then if you think about it, these conditions are exactly the conditions that the moment map for the action of H is zero. So this is the homework proof that this space is coisotropic in O, and the quotient is exactly the Hamiltonian reduction of the orbit with respect to the action, coadjoint action of the Cartan, with respect to the trivial coadjoint orbit in the dual space to the Cartan. Okay, so once you do this homework, you will see that the symplectic leaf is isomorphic to this space as a space, and also you know that this has natural symplectic structure. So then if you look at this space, you recognize that this is the cotangent bundle to H regular. It has its own natural symplectic structure, and so once you identify these as spaces, you have a natural conjecture that this is actually a symplectomorphism. And indeed, one can prove this, but this is a little bit more complicated. So the beautiful fact is that the regular part of the symplectic leaf is equal to this space, is isomorphic to this symplectic orbifold. Okay, so this is the phase space of spin Calogero-Moser systems. This is the Calogero-Moser part, and this is the spin part. Now let's construct Hamiltonians. This is easy. So let's take T star G, trivialized by right translations. So then there is a natural projection from G star cross G to G star. It's obvious that, and it's completely obvious if you look at the Poisson structure, the symplectic structure on T star G. Yes.
Is the usual Calogero-Moser system without spin?
Yes.
The part of this tour.
Yes.
How will we get?
In the usual case, the usual Calogero-Moser corresponds to the following. It's the SLN. In the SLN case, you take the orbit of rank 1, and then the Hamiltonian reduction of the orbit of rank 1 is just one point. This is the constant, Kasdan constant Sternberg construction from. They constructed it for the rational case, but this is just the same. There is no difference. So, okay. So this is a Poisson projection, and then as a corollary, we also have a Poisson projection from T star G mod G to G star mod G. This is a Poisson map. The Poisson structure here is trivial. So what we can do is we can restrict this projection to our symplectic leaf, and then the image of the symplectic leaf with respect to this projection will be in some subspace in G star mod G. And so we have this thing where B is by definition the image of S. And then if you take functions on S, functions on B, then the pullback of functions on B to functions on S gives you a Poisson commutative subalgebra in the algebra of functions on your phase space. So this gives the algebra of Hamiltonians of the spin Calogero-Moser system. But now you want to construct an integrable system, and there will be a little bit of a problem in the sense that you know the dimension of B. We consider the typical situation. The dimension of B is the dimension of this quotient space. The dimension of this quotient space is the dimension of the generic orbits in G star with respect to G. So it's the rank of the Lie algebra. The typical dimension of this symplectic leaf is much bigger. So we obtained natural Hamiltonians, but we have only the rank of them, Poisson commuting Hamiltonians. And if this is the orbit of rank 1, just as in the usual Calogero-Moser system, in this case, the dimension of the symplectic leaf is twice the rank. And then we have the situation of the Liouville integrability when we have R-independent functions on two R-dimensional symplectic manifold, which Poisson commute. So we clearly don't have enough integrals for complete integrability, for Liouville integrability. But then we will see later that this system actually is superintegrable. But before moving in this direction,
Babylon,
yes.
To prove the complete integrability.
Well, you did much.
What is wrong there? Or what
okay. There is nothing wrong with this.
Okay.
Yes. there is nothing wrong with the fact that you proved complete integrability. You actually did, I think, more interesting thing. You proved complete integrability in the elliptic case.
No, it's rational.
I'm talking about the trigonometric case. In this case, yes, you proved complete integrability. But what I'm saying is that there is a refinement of this complete integrability by superintegrability. What I'm saying is that the true dimensions of invariant subspaces of Liouville tori, they are not just half of the dimension of this symplectic leaf, but they are the rank.
Smaller subspace.
Yes. Okay. That's all I'm doing. So now for SLN, let's compute these Hamiltonians. So remember that the XII we identified with coordinates on the cotangent spaces to the Cartan. Mu ij are coordinates on the coadjoint orbit. Hi are coordinates on the regular part of the Cartan. So our Hamiltonians for SLN are just traces of powers of this matrix, and this matrix is nothing but the Lux matrix for the spin Calogero-Moser system. So what we know from the previous slide is that these Hamiltonians are Poisson commutative. So that's a very scientific fact. You don't have to do any computations. I mean, of course, you can prove this by the direct computation, but that will take maybe some years or maybe some weeks. But you don't have to do this. Okay. So, say, if we're talking about compact real form, then the HIs are e to the I Q, because we are in SLN, the sum of these coordinates is zero. So the Hamiltonian is just the usual compact spin Calogero-Moser system. Okay. And the usual Calogero-Moser, non-spin Calogero-Moser system corresponds to the case when we reduce the rank one orbit. That's the case when all mu ij's are constant, the same constant. All right, so now let's prove the superintegrability. Let's prove that, yes.
There are some intermediate cases where you say that the matrix mu ij is a matrix of rank, say, L.
Yep.
So there is a kind of filtration.
Yes.
Each of them is integrable.
Yes, each of them is superintegrable. That's the whole point. You see, if you just have the Liouville integrability,
no, it means that you can parameterize in some special way this space of methods of a constant one, and after such a parameterization, they become just classically.
I didn't hear. They become.
I'm saying that if you parameterize mu ij in a special way as a product of.
Yes.
Then it becomes just a classical.
You're saying something like this.
Yeah. Then maybe in the variables AB, it becomes just a classical.
Okay. The point is that this system is Liouville integrable. But this fact carries less information than superintegrability. Just the same as in the hydrogen atom case. You see, if you don't know this extra length vector, and if you don't know this extra symmetry, you wouldn't know that your level curves have this very special feature that, you know, they are coadjoint orbits of different Lie groups for different levels of the Hamiltonian. So all I'm saying is that this superintegrability gives you more structure. It provides more information. So if you want to construct superintegrability, we should construct this intermediate Poisson manifold of the complementary dimension. In other words, we should prove that this centralizer, in this very special case, which is the algebra of functions on P, has maximal rank. So here's the answer. The answer is that what you should do is you should take the action of G on the cotangent bundle by left translations, by right translations. Both these actions are Hamiltonian, so you have two moment maps, mu left and mu right. And you should apply these moment maps to the pre-image of the symplectic leaf and then mod by G. Some kind of strange procedure. but it works. And you will see that it's less strange if you will pass to moduli spaces. And I'll explain what I meant by this. So in this specific case, this is the Poisson manifold. So then I have to describe the projection from the symplectic leaf, which is, you know, which is the space of orbits through T star G with fixed moment map. So the P1 projection is given by this formula, and the P2 projection is simply a projection to Gx, or the same as Gy. And explicitly, this P can be described as just a subset from G star in G star cross G star. It's the pair of elements in the in the dual space to the Lie algebra such that x minus y belongs to our orbit g, and the coadjoint orbits through x is equal to the coadjoint orbits through y. So this is an exercise, this is a homework exercise to prove this theorem. It's not complicated. If you fail to do this, don't worry. I have a write-up which will be distributed tomorrow with all the explanations. So what should I say? So this is just the reminder what our B is. It's the projection of S. The symplectic leaf is the symplectic leaf in the cotangent bundle, and then this is a subset in G star cross G. Now, let's characterize this B explicitly. So far I defined it as the image of the symplectic leaf S. So now, what is this? It's just, by definition, it's the set of coadjoint orbits in G star such that the difference between O and itself belongs to this fixed coadjoint orbit. In other words, this is the set of coadjoint orbits such that for any y and y prime in O prime, y minus y prime is in O. It looks mysterious, but it's actually not. It's something that has a very natural quantum counterpart. So O prime corresponds to an irreducible representation V lambda if you will quantize it. I don't know, geometrically quantize it or in whatever way you want to quantize it. Minus O prime corresponds to the dual representation, and let's call it mu. And O corresponds to representation V lambda. So the set of these points in B, so quantum version of B O, this is the set of all highest weights mu such that this space of G invariant maps from V mu tensor V mu dual to V lambda is not empty.
There's a part which is hidden.
Yes. Okay.
Didn't see.
All right, I'll say it in words. So this is the set of all highest weights mu such that the home G invariant
must be a summand of endomorphic.
Exactly. Lambda should be summand in this space. And all these representations are finite dimensional. Let's assume that everything is compact. Okay, so now, what is the fiber of P2? So I just want to remind that, so I'm So P2 is the projection from our Poisson manifold to the base. So it should be a symplectic manifold, which is a symplectic leaf of P. So let's look at what is it here. So let's fix O prime in the our set of coadjoint orbits B, satisfying this condition. So then, by definition, the fiber over O prime in P is the set of elements X and Y in G star cross G, such that X minus Y is in O. That's the condition. And then both X and Y are in O prime. And it's kind of written here. So you see, the Poisson manifold P is the set of X, Y, such that X minus Y is in O. And the coadjoint orbit through X is equal to the coadjoint orbit through Y. But now we fixed coadjoint orbit through X by O prime. So this is O prime now, and this is O prime. So what we have here is the condition that both X and Y should belong to O prime. In other words, this space is the space of triples X, Y, Z, where X in O prime, Y is, I change the sign, in minus O prime, and Z in O, such that X plus Y plus Z is 0. And then we mod by G. But this is nothing but O prime cross minus O prime cross O, Hamiltonian reduction with respect to the action of G. So this space has a natural symplectic structure. And this symplectic structure is exactly the symplectic structure on our symplectic leaf. So this is, and just a remark that, you know, keeping the same analogy, so if we'll try to quantize it, then this symplectic leaf, it's a geometric analog of the algebra of endomorphisms of this vector space. G invariant maps from, okay, now it's from the V lambda tensor V lambda dual to V mu, where this lambda and mu are opposite to what I was using here. So, okay. So this is the this is the superintegrability of our system. I know that you don't appreciate. Any questions?
Hmm?
Yes.
Okay, in nowadays, having complete integrability was the dream of anyone. But for Calogero-Moser system, in all days, Pelilov and Nelsanetsky, they simply wrote the answer.
Yep.
So, like, just having initial condition and momentum, you write a matrix, and with
linear. I'm coming to this. I'm coming to this in a second. So this is the beginning of it, the explicit solution. So just repeating what I said, we have the Hamiltonians being G invariant functions on G dual. These are the functions on G invariant functions on our space. So then, so what we have is we have the, yeah, I should probably write it here. So the Hamiltonians, they're actually functions on T star G. They're G invariant functions over here. So then we projected these two T star G mod adjoint G. The Calogero-Moser space is, phase space is a symplectic leaf over here. So now If we will take the Hamiltonians of the Calogero-Moser system and we'll lift them to this space, it's very easy to see that the evolution is very simple. It's just x is not moving at all, and g is moving in this particular way. You take the gradient of the Hamiltonian and act on g from the left. It's a very simple motion. So then, if you want to solve the equations of motions, you know what to do. You take the symplectic leaf in this quotient space, take the orbit, and then the orbit through this point x, t, gt is simply the orbit through this point, and that formula solves the equations of motions. So it's very simple, but I just want to emphasize that there is something here that I'll write it over here so that Igor, you will see it. So where are these cyclic variables that we have the kind of the extra conserved quantities? So remember that the moment map is x minus the coadjoint action of g. So now let's compute mu of xt gt. You see, the multiplication by e to the t, the gradient of h, is on the left. So if you will look at this formula, you will see that this particular mu is constant. And that's the superintegrability. That's what you can fix. So, but this mu is not exactly the mu that's in the residue of the Hamiltonian, because in order to have the mu, the coordinates in the residue of Hamiltonian, we have to diagonalize g. And so, if you will use that coordinates, that coordinates, let me call them mu tilde, the evolution in these coordinates is non-trivial. But in these coordinates, it's completely trivial. And so this is, I'm not saying that this spin Calogero-Moser is a super integrable, super interesting system as a Hamiltonian system. Although it is super interesting when you quantize it. There are different versions of this construction. For example, if you have, there are spin Calogero-Moser systems that are associated to symmetric pairs. So you, for example, you can have Lie algebra, simple Lie algebra G, Cartan involution theta, and the Lie subalgebra of fixed points of the Cartan involution. So then, quantizing these systems is more or less the same as constructing principal series representations of the corresponding split real form. So we're going back to the to yesterday's talks. Let's say so I'm trying to make an argument why this is really interesting, these systems. So for two reasons. First, as an example of a superintegrable system, and second, quantum systems, they are really at the heart of representation theory. So, this is the end of the first lecture. Do I still have time?
Yes, sir. Just a minute.
Oh, okay, good. So then, any questions about the first lecture? Yes.
Poisson, Kajdan,
Stenberg. Mm-hmm.
That actually we get not the phase space of Calogero-Moser, but the completion, which is
exactly
you to consider particles colliding.
Yes, exactly.
Is it the same?
It's the same here. You probably noticed that I was talking specifically about the regular part of the symplectic leaf. If you want to see different strata, then you just have to add.
All these flows extend.
Yeah. Yeah. The nice thing is that, I was considering the regular part so that these denominators, they are non-zero. The Hamiltonian flows, this regular part is invariant with respect to the Hamiltonian flows of the Hamiltonians. If you go to the next strata, all these next strata, they are also invariant. So it's, and I don't know if this has been studied. These flows on this stratified space. Because if you want to consider really the evolution of functions, then it's enough to consider just the regular part, because others will have non-trivial codimension. Okay. Other questions about this or comments? Okay. So let me say a few more words. So this construction is very natural. You trivialize T star G, you consider G invariant functions, you consider the Hamiltonian flow. This formula is totally unnatural. If you don't know some detailed kind of history of this problem, then it's kind of even difficult to guess it. So everything is natural in this business, except for this intermediate algebra P. And so, but fortunately, there is a non-linear deformation of all these systems. Non-linear in the sense that here the Hamiltonian is a quadratic function of the momentum. But the non-linear deformations that I mean is correspond to the Hamiltonian, which is kind of exponential function of the momentum, so-called relativistic versions of Calogero-Moser. So this is what I'm going to start to talk now.
You mean Ruizenar-Schneider?
Pardon?
Ruizenar-Schneider,
spin Ruizenar-Schneider, all of them. Vista. Modalita. Schermo intero. I'm trying to learn Italian. Okay. All right, so let me make a summary of what we did. So the first lecture, I introduced the notion of superintegrability. The second lecture, this is what happened. So we constructed these superintegrable systems. But the superintegrability was somewhat ad hoc. I didn't explain where these intermediate Poisson manifolds came from. So now, how many minutes do I have?
Still 10 minutes, because before, I mean, you were
okay.
Just
10 minutes. So,
less than
okay. So let me make an overview of the third lecture, and then we'll go through the details tomorrow. So first, we changed the setting. So now the symplectic manifolds are very natural symplectic manifolds. We have a surface, so let's fix a surface. Possibly with boundary, topological surface. We don't fix any complex structure in it. So, and then the representation variety for a surface is just a set of group homomorphisms from pi 1 of the surface to G with some base point P0. So, the character variety is even more natural thing. So you see this space of homomorphisms depend on the point P0. So I didn't write it here, but it should be here. So if you consider the set of the conjugacy classes, then this space doesn't depend on any base point. So this is some kind of completely natural thing. So there is a natural symplectic structure on this moduli space. So this is the same as the moduli space of flat connections on the surface, flat G connection, flat connections in the principal G bundle over this surface. So the space of connections on E, it has a natural symplectic structure. This goes, so this is the symplectic form, this is the Atyiah-Bott construction. So it's an infinite dimensional, the space of connections on sigma, it's an infinite dimensional symplectic space. And on this infinite dimensional symplectic space, there is an action of the infinite dimensional gauge group, gauge transformations of connections. You see, because over a closed surface, the principal G bundle, any principal G bundle is trivializable. So we can identify connections with one forms, but only as a space. As a G space, these spaces are different.
Shouldn't you take the trace in the integral?
Yes, I forgot the trace in the integral. Thank you. So, okay. So then there is a Hamiltonian reduction, and then this was the kind of Atyiah-Bott and Bott discovery that the space of this character variety is the same as the Hamiltonian reduction of the space of connections with respect to the action of the gauge group. And so it has a natural symplectic structure. So since it has a natural symplectic structure, we have natural Poisson structure. And then this is what I will do tomorrow. We'll introduce certain way how to deal with this space, a certain class of functions that span the functions on the moduli space, the so-called graph functions. And in terms of these graph functions, the Poisson structure is particularly simple. It can be written in terms of the intersections of graphs. So then, if you have a surface with boundary, it's a Poisson manifold. It's not a symplectic manifold. But its symplectic leaves will be fixed if you will fix the conjugacy classes over the components of the boundary. And here's the construction of a superintegrable system that I will explain tomorrow. First, choose any collection of cycles, simple cycles in sigma, non-intersecting, non-self-intersecting. Define the subalgebra in the algebra of functions on this moduli space. The algebra of, do I still have time?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So I will define naturally the Poisson commutative subalgebra as the algebra of holonomies, traces of holonomies along these cycles. And then the centralizer of this algebra in the algebra of functions on the whole moduli space is just simply the span of these graph functions for graphs that don't intersect these cycles. So it's a very natural thing. And the theorem is that this is the this is a superintegrable system in the sense that this centralizer has maximal rank. This is in our recent paper with Artamonov from September 2019. So the particular case of this is when you have a torus with one puncture, that's when, yeah, you can use the Poisson brackets given by Falk and Rosley to lift the symplectic structure from Poisson structure from G cross G mod G to G cross G. This G cross G is the analog of the cotangent bundle to G. It's a kind of nonlinear version of the cotangent bundle in the sense that this G star is replaced by the Lie group itself. Now, there is no natural symplectic structure on G cross G. You can choose Falk and Rosley. There is another choice. You can choose this symplectic structure to be not symplectic, but so-called quasi-symplectic, in the sense that it's symplectic up to homotopy. But I think I prefer Falk and Rosley because, you know, to work with things up to homotopy is usually difficult. So, and then if you look at this superintegrability structure, you can see that this is exactly the nonlinear version of what we did before. This is the spin Calogero-Moser system. This is the nonlinear version of it. And then this is the Ruzina-Schneider relativistic Calogero-Moser and all of this. So that's the part for the moduli space. That's the part of the Calogero-Moser system. But then there is also a very interesting case when you have a torus with n punctures. That corresponds to some kind of interacting spin Calogero-Moser systems and quantization of this situation. It's exactly the something that Ettinghoff and Varchenko studied, the dynamical Knishnik-Zamolodchikov equations and trace functions. So so that's the announcement. And the details tomorrow.
Okay. So thank you.
Are there any more questions from the audience? Yes, please.
This is very vague because I don't remember the details, but it's related to what Krishna said. That, so you have a completion considering the case of particle collapsing.
Yep.
Now remember there was maybe 10 years ago work of Wilson which constructed a sort of different completion which turns out to be related to the Hilbert scheme of the plane. Is it any visible in our...
No, I think Wilson just...
No, it's just the same.
For this completion.
Yeah. It's he gave a description, yes. I think it's Wilson and Berest, some joint papers.
No, later. This is a paper of Wilson.
The old one.
On Wilson.
Yeah.
But, I mean, the connection with the Hilbert scheme of the plane.
Yeah, if you want to...
visible?
Yes, if you want to describe this whole symplectic... Not, I cannot say it's a manifold. It's not a manifold. It's some symplectic space, singular symplectic space. If you want to describe it completely, this will be some kind of spin version of what Wilson did. So in addition to this completion, there will be some spin variables, and one has to deal with this. I don't think it's done.
Okay, yeah.
It's an open problem. I mean, as far as... So what is the spin version of this Wilson... result.
Because in a way, I can guess the answer. It's not
okay.
But actually, it was the same way as Calogero-Moser came as a rational, again, a metric or elliptic solution of KP spin matrix version.
Ah, okay. So you're suggesting to go through KP.
Just the same KP, but in
okay.
Matrix.
Yeah.
That should be the same.
So I think there are two ways to do it, you know, from KP or from this finite dimensional kind of symplectic algebraic geometry. But Igor, has it been done really kind of written somewhere? I mean, it's easy to guess the answer.
The relation between spin Calogero-Moser and matrix KP, it's written.
Yes.
But but the extension of this spectral transform Allard Wilson to these matrix cases.
But is it only for SLN, the relation to KP?
Only for SLN, nobody did.
Not for E8.
Okay. You should have a long list of students.
Yes. All right.
Okay, so are there any questions? If not, let's thank the speaker again.